evening to all. So let me recall. Yesterday, we defined what do we mean by residue, and residue at a pole, and pole of order k, and we have seen some applications. And yesterday, we have seen that if an improper integral of this kind p of x by q of x dx, where p and q are polynomials, where q of x not equals to 0 and p of x q of x have real coefficients and degree of q of x is greater than degree of p of x plus 2, then yesterday I have given a method through which we can solve the improper integral by constructing the contour, say CR is nothing but set of all z belongs to C such that maybe set of all z such that your z is nothing but r e power I theta, where 0 less than equals to theta less than equals to pi. That means we are taking a semi circle in the approx plane. Okay, so through this we have solved one problem. Okay, so integral minus infinity to infinity 1 by 1 plus x square dx, because here p of x equals to 1 and q of x equals to 1 plus x square, so this satisfies all the conditions. Okay, we have done this problem. Suppose if we want to evaluate, if we want to evaluate integral minus infinity to infinity p of x by q of x into cos ax, or integral minus infinity to infinity p of x by q of x into sin ax. This kind of integral arises in the Fourier analysis. So sometimes we call these are Fourier integrals. Okay, Fourier integrals. So what we need to do, we cannot straight away can take here, in this case we have taken our f of z as 1 by 1 plus z square. So what we do here, we take our f of z as p of z by q of z into e power I a z. Okay, so then we do our normal integration, contour integration. At the end, we will take real and imaginary part of this, then we will obtain the required integral, whatever we want the integral. Okay, so this is what. Okay, so now what we are saying, this is where p of x and q of x condition that with real coefficients. Okay, and our q of x not equals to 0. So here we have the condition that the degree of q is greater than degree of p plus 2. Here we will slightly weaken this condition. So the what we will take here, and degree of q of x is greater than degree of p p of x plus 1. Okay, this is what we are taking the hypothesis. Okay, so with this we want to solve the improper integrals of this kind. Okay, so let us see. If this is the case, what we will obtain? So instead of taking here cos az or sin az, why we have taken e power I a z? Okay, suppose if you take sin az, okay, so this can be written as e power I a z minus e power minus I a z by I. So assume our a is greater than 0. Okay, so this can be written as, so along y axis, positive y axis, when I am going along positive y axis, okay, so here x equals to 0 along positive y axis. So this is nothing but e into iy, your x equals to 0, minus e power minus ia into iy. So this is same as e power minus ay minus e power ay by 2i. Okay, so if I take the 1 by I common, or this can be written as minus I by 2 into e power minus ay minus e power ay. So this is same as I by 2 into e power ay minus e power minus ay. And now this goes to 0, okay, as y goes to infinity. Okay. Okay. So therefore, we are not taking of this form f of z is equals to p of z by q of z into cos az or sin az. In this form we are not taking. This is the reason. Okay, because sin az cos az grows faster than the polynomial, okay, along the y axis. So therefore we are taking e power iaz if your a is greater than 0. Okay, and we take the same CR, okay, on the semi contour in the upper half plane, and we will solve the problem. Okay, for example, the reason is, now let us see that modulus of e power iaz, this can be written as, okay, modulus of e power ia into x plus iy. So this can be written as e power minus ay. Am I right? Because e power modulus of iax is 0. So now if I take imaginary part of z greater than equals to 0 and a is strictly greater than 0, therefore this is less than equals to e power 0 equals to 1. Therefore e power iaz is bounded when a greater than 0, okay, in set of all z such that your imaginary part of z greater than 0. Suppose in case a less than 0, okay, if a is strictly less than 0, so what we will do in that case, this e power iaz is bounded by 1. Where can someone tell where it is bounded by 1 if a less than 0? In set of all z such that imaginary part of z is less than equals to 0. Okay, so am I right? The imaginary, if a less than 0, then what will happen? if a less than 0, okay, and you are taking in the lower of plane, okay, so this will be bounded by 1. Okay, so either you can take, if a less than 0, you can take either this is the contour, or you can take, or you can define our f of z as p of z by q of z into e power minus a z. Okay, and your cr is nothing but set of all z such that z is equals to r e power I theta 0 less than r cos theta less than equals to pi. So same AR you are taking, same CR you are taking, the contour, semi-contour circle, but here instead of e power iaz, you are taking e power minus iaz. Okay, then it works. Okay, so let us solve a problem. Evaluate integral minus infinity to infinity cos ax by x square plus m square into dx. Okay, for m greater than 0 and a greater than 0. These are the conditions are given. Okay, so here what we have to consider, let f of z is equals to, okay, e power iaz by z square plus m square. So z is equals to plus or minus m I r of f of z. So I think there is a slow network. I will just, can you give me 1 minute? I will change the position. Yeah, so z is equals to plus or minus mi are the simple poles of f of z. That means, so this is our capital M, is our m is greater than 0, so this is mi. So I want to choose r greater than m. Okay, so let me take a contour, okay, which contains our mi. So this is minus r to r. Okay, so now consider our contour, okay, as following, from minus r to r, and this cr, the semi circular contour, okay. So we are doing the integration. So let your C equals to CR union minus R to R. So this I am calling as CR. Okay, good. So now integral over C f of z dz equals to integral over minus r to r f of x dx plus integral over C r f of z dz. Okay, now our claim is to prove this integral is zero. Okay, our claim is, okay, integral CR over f of z goes to zero, dz goes to zero as r goes to infinity. Okay, so how to do it? This is simple. So note that e power iaz, okay, so what is this? Let me write one more term so that it indicates. So integral r f of z dz is nothing but integral cr, this is nothing but e power iaz by z square plus m square into dz. Okay, so now let us see the bound for the e power iaz. Okay, so modulus of e power iaz is nothing but e power minus ay, this is less than equal to e power 0, this is bounded by 1. Okay, for all z belongs to the upper half plane, so this I am denoting by h plus. This is nothing but set of all z belongs to C such that, okay, imaginary part of z is greater than or equals to 0. Now by using ML inequality, we can write integral over CR f of z dz equals to integral CR, okay, e power iaz by z square plus m square into dz, and this is less than or equals to the numerator, this is bounded by 1, okay, therefore I can write this one as pi r by r square minus m square, because I can always write this mod z square plus m square is greater than or equals to mod z square minus m square. This is same as r square minus m square. So if I take the reciprocate, okay, reciprocal, then I can get 1 by r square minus m square. Now this goes to 0, okay, as r goes to infinity. So now the left hand side of this quantity we have to see what is its value. So here we will apply Cauchy-Riesz theorem. Since z is equals to mi is the only simple pole, life inside C, the integral over C f of z dz is nothing but 2 pi I times residue of f of z at mi, okay, by residue theorem. Okay. Now what is the residue of f of z if z is equal to mi? So since mi is a simple pole, this is nothing
1 by 2 mi
limit. Yeah, very good. But okay, this is nothing but limit z goes to mi, okay, z minus im into e power iaz by z square plus m square. So its value is nothing but e power ia into im by 2im. Okay. So this can be written as e power minus am by 2im. Okay. Therefore, integral over c f of z dz is nothing but 2 pi I times e power minus am by 2 I m. Okay, this is nothing but pi e power, okay, what is value? By m. Am I right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So therefore, by letting r goes to infinity, what we are getting, so right hand side is pi into e power minus am by m equals to integral minus infinity to infinity f of x dx. So what is this? This is nothing but integral minus infinity to infinity. Okay. So this value is nothing but e power iax by x square plus m square into dx. So this is same as, now if we take the real and imaginary part, this can be written as integral minus infinity to infinity cos ax by x square plus m square plus I times integral minus infinity to infinity sine ax by x square plus m square into dx. By comparing the real and imaginary part, okay, by comparing real and imaginary parts, on both sides, we obtain the following. So this is nothing but the real part of this. So therefore, integral minus infinity to infinity cos ax by x square plus m square into dx equals to the left hand side quantity, okay, pi into e power minus am by m. Okay, and the second quantity is zero, and integral minus infinity to infinity sine ax by x square plus m square into dx equals to zero. Okay, good. So one can study this kind of problems. Okay, so suppose if you want to say take certain kind of integrals, so which has certain branch cuts, okay, then how to take it? Okay, so let us take an example of a function. Example. So evaluate integral minus infinity to infinity or 0 to infinity, let us take 0 to infinity, x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx. Okay, so what we will do here, we can see that if you consider the function f of z is nothing but z to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus z square, okay, we are getting a branch, okay, because this is a multivalued function. Okay, so in this case, what we do, consider your f of z is nothing but z to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus z square. Okay, so we will choose proper branch, okay, because a square root of a transformation or even square root transformation, okay, is defined for a non-zero complex number. Okay, so what we do, we will take so z is equal to 0 is here. Z is equal to 0. So what I want to see that z is equal to plus or minus I are the singularities for f of z. Okay. So z is equal to 0, z is equal to plus or minus I are the singularities of f of z. So I'm having here I, here minus I. Okay. Now what I will do, I will choose a small r and capital R such that from here, okay, I go around this around origin, okay, and then I will move okay. So similarly, I will move from here and I will come back covering this I and this. So let me write the picture properly. Okay. Therefore, by defining a proper branch, and I here my function is analytic except at minus I and I. Okay. By taking this, my function f of z is analytic, because if I define this domain, okay, an appropriate branch, then this function becomes an analytic function except at I and minus I. Okay. Now this is a simply connected domain, so I want to do the contour integration here. That is the idea. Okay. Okay. Now we are considering the f of z is equals to z to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus z square. Now what we are doing here, the following. So suppose this is R, this is R, and this is capital R. So we are moving in this direction. Okay. So this small inner circle I will call as C small r, and outer circle I will call as CR. Okay. So now if we give the name, if I give the names, this is A, B, this is CR, okay, so this is R, and this is some say D, whatever it may be. So I want to do the integration. The integration, my whole C is nothing but, my whole C is nothing but this line and this contour, and again this line, okay, and inside the contour this. Okay. I think I don't know, it's not working. Are you able to see the highlighter? Hello?
No,
Hello?
sir. No, sir,
Just
we
a
are not
minute,
able
just a
to
minute.
see.
Yeah. Yeah, now again I will explain. So we want to take the integration. Now I want to take the integration along this line. Deepa, can you please mute the mic? So we want to do the integration along this line and along this contour, outer contour, and along this line, and I want to take from the inside the contour. Okay. So what I want to do is the following. First, we choose the branch of the function our f of z is nothing but z to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus z square, so defined in a c minus 0, defined on c minus singleton 0, or what we do, c minus, I will take the further thing, c minus closed zero infinity, this we will take. Okay, so now what your z is, we are taking z is equal to r e power I theta, where 0 less than theta less than 2 pi. Now consider the c. Okay, consider the contour c as c equals to what I am writing from. If I want to give a naming here, I will give this, I will call as some name E, and anyhow I am calling as this is B. So I will call that one as, from this is one line segment and this is another, this another line segment, and this I will take as another curve. Okay, so my C is nothing but capital CR union line segment. Okay, so I'm calling this one as ED. Okay, what I call, I will say that for convenience, I will call that ED. Then union our CR. Then union AB. Okay, so over this I want to do the integration. Okay, now our f of z is analytic in C except at z is equals to I and minus I. Okay, our function f of z is analytic except at z is equals to I and minus I. Okay, since f of z is analytic on and between C except for the simple poles z is equals to plus or minus I. Therefore, integral over C f of z dz is nothing but 2 pi I times the residue of f of z at I plus residue of f of z at minus I, okay, due to residue theorem. Okay, now the integral what we are making, this left hand side of the integral. Actually, I think there is some net issue. Therefore, I switched on the video, thinking that at least there will be a good network. Let me see. Yeah. So, since here the net is little bad condition, therefore I switched off my video. So now, yeah, So integral over C, f of z dz is nothing but 2 pi I times the residue of I and residue of f minus I, okay, because of residue theorem. Now our integral over C, f of z dz is nothing but integral over CR plus integral over ED plus integral over CR plus integral over AD. Okay. So, okay. This is of z dz. Okay. F of x dx. This is f of x dx. Sorry, f of z dz. This is f of x dx. Okay. Now let us first compute the integral over CR. Okay. First can okay. Now we want to compute this integral. So what I want to say that the absolute value of this integral becomes zero. Okay. So first we will do the absolute value of integral over CR z to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus z square into dz. This is less than equals to by ML inequality, or I'm taking the absolute value inside the integral. This is over CR. Now this is same as R power 1 by 3 by R square minus 1 into mod dz. Okay. Still let me check the connectivity. Yeah, it is there. It's a full connectivity is okay. So now this is less than or equals to 2 pi r into r to the power of 1 by 3 by r square. So this is same as 2 pi into 1 by r to the power of 2 by 3, and this goes to 0 as r goes to infinity. Okay. Similarly, we will prove that. Okay, similarly, we will prove that integral over CR f of z also goes to 0 as small r goes to 0. Okay, so this is absolute value is nothing but modulus of CR z to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus z square into dz, and this is less than or equals to integral over CR r to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 minus r square into mod dz, because we are doing on a circle with center 0 and radius r. So now this is less than or equals to r power 1 by 3 into 2 pi r, because as r goes to 0, okay, can I write directly, okay? Can I write directly this goes to 0 as r goes to 0? Therefore, both integral CR f of z dz goes to 0 as r goes to 0, and integral over CR f of z dz goes to 0 as r goes to infinity. So now we want to find out the integral of f of z dz over AB. Okay. Now this is same as integral R to capital R. So if you see this AB, the picture, so here the integral from R to capital R. So this is small r to capital R, I'm doing the integration. X to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx. So this is same as limit r goes to 0 and capital R goes to infinity. Okay. Integral over ab f of dz is same as integral 0 to infinity x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx. Okay, so I'm just keeping this one as our integration, okay, because this is what we required. So we are just keeping this integration, and let us consider another integral, integral e to d f of z dz. Okay, so this is nothing but, so here we are doing the integration from r, okay, capital R to small r. Here capital R to small r. So this is nothing but integral capital R to small r e power, so here what is your z? Your z is nothing but x into e power by I on ed. Okay, so this is nothing but e power 2 pi I x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus e power 2 pi I into x whole square, and I'm writing e power 2 pi I into x dx. Okay, instead of z I'm substituting x into e power 2 pi I. Now if we evaluate this one, this is nothing but integral capital R to small r e power 2 pi I by 3 into x power 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx. Now if I change this, okay, order, so I can write this one as minus of, okay, e power 2 pi I by 3 integral small r to capital R x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx. Okay, now limit small r goes to 0 and capital R goes to infinity, your ed f of z dz is nothing but this quantity, the right hand side quantity, okay, integral 0 to infinity. So this is nothing but minus e power 2 pi I by 3 integral 0 to infinity x power 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx. So in the four integrals, we proved that two integrals are zero, and another two integrals we found its value. Okay. Therefore, so therefore the right hand side, the left hand side of this integral is nothing but 2 pi I times the sum of the residues, right? Here, okay, if I take this integral, okay, which I am just or else this integral over c f of z dz is nothing but 2 pi I times residue of f at I and residue of f at minus I. Okay, so I'm finding now residue of f of z at I, since z is equal to I is a simple pole, this is nothing but limit z goes to I, okay, z to the power of 1 by 3, or you can write one step and you can write z minus I into f of z. So this is same as limit z goes to I, z to the power of 1 by 3 by z plus I. So this is a simplification, it gives that e power minus I pi by 3 by 2. And similarly, one can find out the residue of f of z at minus I as 1 by 2 e power minus I into pi by 2. Okay. Therefore, integral 0 to infinity x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx, okay, minus e power 2 pi I by 3 into integral 0 to infinity x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx, the second integral, okay, and we are having 0 and another integral is 0, okay. This is same as integral over c f of z dz, and its value is nothing but 2 pi I times minus 1 by 2. Okay, this value can be written into minus 1 by 2. So this is minus 1 by 2 plus e power minus I into pi by 3 by 2. Okay. Now, if I take this integral 0 to infinity x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx common here and here, so what we will get? This implies integral 0 to infinity x to the power of 1 by 3 by 1 plus x square dx equals to 2 pi I times. Okay. So this, I am doing the simplification, this is nothing but e power minus I into pi by 3 minus 1 by 2 by 1 minus e power 2 pi I by 3. Okay. So this is for this. So I am just leaving here. Okay. So when we have a branch cut, okay, what we will do? When the multivalued function appears in the function in the given integral, so we will choose a proper branch and we will do the integration, okay, in other contour by taking out this point zero. Okay, so other kind of problems will be covered in the tutorial session. So let me define what do you mean by meromorphic function. Okay, yesterday we started on that. Okay, a function is said to be meromorphic, okay, if the only singularities are nothing but the poles. Okay. Let me define. Meromorphic function. A function f of z is meromorphic on a domain D if f of z is analytic on D, except possibly at isolated singularities, and each of which is a pole. Okay, each of R. Each of which is a pole. For example, we have studied many meromorphic functions. For example, your f of z is nothing but 1 by z plus z. Okay, this is a meromorphic function. Okay, now if we have certain kind of meromorphic functions, okay, so for example, if you take, we have considered the same kind of function g of z is nothing but 1 by 1 plus z square. Okay, when we have integrated integral minus infinity to infinity dx by 1 plus x square dx. So here we have considered a meromorphic function 1 by 1 plus z square. Okay, the only singularities are here z is equals to plus or minus I, which are simple poles. Okay, then for such kind of meromorphic functions, we have very nice counting principle. It is called the argument principle. Okay, I will explain. So let me give the theorem statement. It is called argument principle. So I will give you at the end of this proof, I will give you why we call this one as an argument principle. Okay, let f of z be analytic inside and on a simple closed curve, simple closed contour C, except for a finite number of poles inside C, inside C. Suppose that f of z not equals to 0 on C. Okay, now we are denoting two symbols. If nf and pf are the number of zeros, this nf is called number of zeros, np pf is nothing but number of poles with counting multiplicity. That means if it is zero of order k, I will take k its answer is. Okay, so are represented are respectively the number of zeros and zeros with counting multiplicity. Okay, so what do you mean by here counting multiplicity means that is a zero of order k is counted k times. That is the meaning. Okay. And poles with counting multiplicity. So these the number of poles and number of zeros with counting multiplicity are inside C. Then integral 1 by 2 pi integral over C f dash of z by f of z dz is nothing but nf minus pf. Okay, so what it says that suppose we have a domain, okay, suppose we have simple closed curve C, suppose I treat my green colors are nothing but the number of zeros, okay. And I will count my blue colors are poles. Okay, these are poles, and these are zeros. Okay, inside your C, okay, on simple closed contour. Then this integration indicates that suppose this zero is okay is of order 2, it will be counted 2 times. So we are writing that NF, that means the number of zeros minus number of poles. Okay, so the proof is very simple. It's just 2 lines proof. Let F of Z have zeros at Z1, Z2, Zn and poles at W1, W2, Wn with multiplicity. So what I will write that let Z1, Z2, so on Zn be poles, okay, of F of Z with multiplicity, say alpha 1, alpha 2, so on alpha n. That means the multiplicity of Z1, Z1 is a pole of 0 of order alpha, Z2 is a 0 of order alpha 2, and Zn is 0 of order alpha n. And W1, W2, WN WM are poles of F of Z with multiplicity, say beta 1, beta 2, and so on, beta M. So then we can always express our F of Z as Z minus Z1 to the power of alpha 1, Z minus Z2 to the power of alpha 2, and so on, Z minus Zn to the power of alpha n by W minus W1 to the power of beta 1, W minus W2 to the power of beta 2, and W minus WM to the power of beta M. Okay, into some analytic function I can write, okay, into F of Z, where your capital F of Z is analytic inside C without any zeros and poles. Okay, now clearly this F of Z is a meromorphic function, am I right? Here F of Z is a meromorphic function. Okay, now what I want to say that I want to take the logarithmic derivative for this F of Z. Okay, what do you mean by logarithmic derivative? So the logarithmic derivative means d of log z, log of f of z is nothing but f dash of z by f of z. Okay, so if I take the logarithmic derivative to this function f, okay, I will call 1, okay, by taking logarithmic derivative to 1, what we get, left hand side will get f dash of z by f of z. Okay, now if I take logarithmic, that means I am taking the log and doing the derivative, that means what I will get, alpha 1 by z minus z1 plus alpha 2 by z minus z2 and so on, plus alpha n by z minus zn. Okay, so that I can write as alpha j by z minus zj, where your j is from 1 to n, minus summation j is equals to 1 to m beta j by z minus zj, plus your capital F is there, so that can be written as capital F dash of z by F of z. Okay, this I will call as 2. Now what I will do, so I'm drawing the picture again. So suppose, okay, this is your curve C, simple closed contour. And as I said, suppose I have z1, z2, and so on, my zn, these are the zeros. And w1, w2, and so on, wn, wm, these are the poles. So I will take, since these are finitely many, so I will take a circle around z1 in the clockwise direction. I will call this is c1, and I will take another circle c2, and I will take cn, which is oriented in the clockwise direction. And similarly for this, I will call c1 tilde, c2 tilde, and cm tilde, so that in each circle, there is no other singularity or poles. If I take the circle C1, okay, no other singularity poles lies here. If I take the C1 tilde, no other singularity pole lies inside. Okay, so let me write. Enclose each pole and zero by distant circles contains no pole and zeros. So this is the way we are constructing, okay, the circles. Therefore, if I do the integration, okay, f of z, f dash of z by f of z dz, okay, and doing by 1 by 2 pi I, so this is nothing but summation j equals to 1 to n your alpha j by 2 pi I integral over C dz by z minus zj. This is a finite summation, minus summation j equals to 1 to n beta j by 2 pi I integral over C dz by z minus zj, wj, or this is wj. Okay, now see that in this circle we have only one zero. In this circle we have only one zero, so its winding number is 1. Okay, in the pole we have only one pole, so its winding number is 1. Okay, therefore this is nothing but summation j equals to 1 to n. Okay, so this value is always 1, am I right? Because its winding number is 1. Okay, so that means if I include this 1 over 2 pi I, now this value is 1. Now, if I include this 1 by 2 pi I, this value is 1. Okay? Therefore, this is nothing but summation j equals to 1 to n, this is nothing but alpha j minus summation j equals to 1 to n, this is nothing but beta j. Okay? So, what we have taken? This summation j equals to 1 to n, your alpha j is nothing but your nf. And summation j equals to 1 to n, your beta j is nothing but pf. That means this is the number of zeros with counting multiplicity, number of poles with counting multiplicity. Okay. This completes the proof. Okay. So now let us see why we call this one as an argument principle. Okay. So sometimes we call this as a counting principle for the following reason. Okay. Suppose f is analytic and non-zero for all z in a simple closed contour C. Okay. Suppose f of z is analytic and non-zero for all z on a simple closed contour C. So let us set our log of f of z, okay? By fixing branch, I will write ln of mod z, f of mod z, plus I into argument of f of z. Okay? Where a fixed branch of the logarithm is chosen. Okay? Where a fixed branch chosen. Now, if you take any simple closed curve, okay, integral f dash of z by f of z over c dz, I can always write integral over c d of log f of z. Now, this is nothing but ln of mod f of z over c plus I into argument of f of z over c, where c is a simple closed contour. Okay. Now, since c is simple closed contour, what is its value? That means its end point and initial points are same. So, what is its value?
Zero.
Very good. Since C is closed curve, okay, ln of mod f of z evaluated on this C is 0. Okay, therefore its initial and final points are same. Therefore, integral over C f dash of z by f of z dz is nothing but I into argument of f of z over the simple closed curve C. Okay, I will call this one as 1. Okay, so this LH is this quantity, integral over C f dash of z by f of z dz, depends only on the net change of the argument. Am I right? As z traverses on the contour, when z is traverses on this contour, this is nothing but the net change of the argument of f of z. Okay. Therefore, the LHS of 1 depends only on the net change in the argument of argument of f of z as z traverses over C. Okay, that means the net change in argument of f of z on the contour C is called the variation of this argument of f of z, and this we denote it by delta of argument of z. Okay, so the net change in argument of f of z as z traverses on the contour C is called the variation of argument of f of z along C, and this we denote it by the net change of the argument of f of z. Therefore this quantity, okay, without I, so this quantity I will write as delta of argument of f of z. Okay, so from 1 integral over C, your f dash of z by f of z dz is nothing but I into delta of C argument of f of z. Okay, now what our argument principle says? The argument principle says that by argument principle 1 by 2 pi I times integral over C f dash of z by f of z dz is nothing but 1 by 2 pi I times I into delta of C into argument of f of z. That means the net change of the argument. Okay. So, and we proved that indeed this is nothing but NF minus PF. This is by argument principle. Okay. Therefore, 1 by 2 pi, because if I cancel I and I here, okay, 1 by 2 pi delta, that means net change of the argument of f of z is nothing but NF minus PF. Okay, so geometrically this is known as the argument principle. Okay, geometrically this star is known as the argument principle. So this will be widely used in the Navalina theory in counting the number of zeros and poles of a given meromorphic function. Okay, so one such beautiful application of this argument principle is Cauchy's theorem. Okay, so let me state, proof is very simple. Okay, maybe after that I will just give the applications of both the things with an examples. So an application is, okay, Cauchy's theorem. Okay, what the Cauchy's theorem says that if f and j are two analytic functions on a simple closed contour C, such that your modulus of g of z is less than modulus of f of z on C, then f and f plus g has same number of zeros inside C. Okay, so what it says that suppose f of z and g of z are analytic inside and on a simple closed contour C with modulus of g of z less than modulus of f of z on C, then f plus g has the same number of zeros, not same zeros, the same number of zeros as f of z inside C. Okay, so by seeing this statement, we can see that whether our f is, whether modulus of f of z greater than 0, can I say clearly in view of this, in view of modulus of g of z less than modulus of f of z, can I say that our modulus of f of z is strictly greater than 0 on C?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. And also, what is given that modulus of f of z, g of z less than modulus of f of z. Therefore, I can write that modulus of f of z plus g of z is greater than or equal to modulus of f of z minus modulus of g of z. And now this is strictly greater than 0. So on C. So what it means that f and f plus g has no zeros on C. Okay, that is f of z and f of z plus g of z have no zeros inside C. Okay, and since f is analytic, so it doesn't have any pole. F and g are analytic, so f and f plus g have no poles. Okay, since f of z plus g of z are analytic, f of z, so I can write that PF is 0 and P of F plus G is 0. Now, let us write our F plus G as F into 1 plus G by F. Because G is, F is non-vanishing because of this condition, because F is non-vanishing, so I can write G by F. So this I will write as F into phi, where my phi is 1 plus g by f. So where the g by f, what is given? Given that our modulus of g of z is less than modulus of f of z, right? So this implies modulus of g of z by f of z is less than 1 on C. That means modulus g of z by f of z lies inside a circle disk with center 0 and radius 1. Okay, so now let us note that what is f plus g dash. So this is nothing but f dash of z into so what we can write easily, 1 plus g of z by f of z plus f of z into 1 plus g of z by f of z whole derivative. Okay. Therefore, our f plus g whole dash by f plus g of z, if we compute, this is nothing but f dash of z by f of z plus 1 plus g of z by f of z whole dash by 1 plus g of z by f of z. So this is nothing but f dash by f of z plus this is nothing but phi dash of z by phi of z. Okay. So this implies your f plus g whole dash of z by f plus g of z minus f dash of z by f of z is nothing but phi dash of z by phi of z. What is your phi? Phi is an analytic function. Okay. Now, let us denote our nf is the number of zeros of f, and n of f plus g is nothing but number of zeros of f plus g. The number of zeros of f and f plus g respectively with counting multiplicity. Okay. On a domain bounded by C. Okay. Now, what we obtained, we have seen that f and g are analytic functions. F and g are analytic functions. They don't have zeros on C. So I can apply argument principle here. By argument principle, okay, our 1 by 2 pi I times integral over C f plus g whole dash of g by f plus g of z, okay, minus f dash by f of z, okay, into dz. Its value is nothing but what? N of f plus g minus n of f. Okay, this here I am applying the argument principle. Okay. But in view of this, let me call this is double star. In view of double star, this value is nothing but double star. This value is nothing but 1 by 2 pi I integral over C or phi dash of z by phi of z dz. Okay. Please note that our phi of z is nothing but g of z by f of z, and its absolute value is less than 1. Okay. Therefore, our phi lies, okay, so I think, I'm sorry, our phi is nothing but not this actually. Our phi is nothing but 1 plus of this. I'm sorry. Our phi is nothing but 1 plus g by f, and modulus of g by f is less than 1. Okay. Therefore, our phi lies inside the disk modulus of W minus 1 less than 1. for all that belongs to C. Now, if we take proper branch of this phi, then this represents an analytic function. So this value becomes zero. Okay, so let me write. Taking a branch of the logarithm on the simply connected domain W minus 1 less than 1, we have phi dash of by phi are nothing but d by dz of log of phi of z. Therefore, let me call this one as triple star. So from triple star, our n of f plus g minus nf, okay, equals to zero. This implies your nf plus g is same as nf. Okay, so the number of zeros of f and the number of zeros of f plus g are same inside C. Okay. So one can see with nice examples, okay, to illustrate this one. Okay, so let me take an example. Suman, can I take just 5 minutes extra?
Yes, sir. You carry on.
Okay. Thank you. So let me take an example. Example, let our f of z is nothing but say z plus 1 into z plus 7 whole to the power of 5 into z minus I whole square by say z square minus 2z plus 2 into z plus I whole to the power of 8 into z minus 5i to the power of 8. Okay, so this is the function I'm taking my C as set of all z belongs to C such that mod z equals to 2. Okay, now find integral over mod z equals to 2 f dash of z by f of z dz. This is what our question is. Okay, so one is a direct method to find out. Okay, there is no doubt. So we can give the alternative method using argument principle. Okay, so let us draw the picture. We have mod z equals to 2. This is 2. So if we take this one, how many zeros lies for the function z is equals to minus 1 lies inside, and z is equals to minus 7 lies here, and z is equals to I lies here. Okay, so therefore z is equals to minus 1 is a zero of order 1, and z is equals to I is of order 2 lies inside. Okay, so clearly z is equals to 1, z is equals to minus 1, and z is equals to I lies inside C equals to mod z equals to 2. Therefore, your n is nothing but minus 1. See, the minus 1 is a order of 1, therefore this is 1, and I is of order 2, therefore this is 2, therefore this is 3. Okay, nf I can write. Okay, now the denominator z square minus 2z plus 2, this can be written as z minus 1 whole square plus 1. And this is 0 if and only if or z is equals to 1 plus or minus I. Okay. So what is the absolute value of this? Whether these two points lies inside C or outside C?
Inside.
Okay. So z is equals to 1 plus I plus or minus I lies inside C. Now z is equals to 1 plus I, okay, this is a pole of order how much? Is a pole of order how much?
1 4.
And z is equals to 1 minus I is a pole of order 4. Okay, these are lying inside. Okay, so z is equals to minus I is a pole of order how much?
8.
Therefore, your PF is nothing but 4 plus 4 plus 8. Because that 5i lies outside, so I'm not counting that. So this is how much? 16. Therefore, by argument principle, your 1 by 2 pi I integral over C f dash of z dz f dash by f of z dz is nothing but nf minus pf. So this is nothing but 3 minus 16. So this is nothing but minus 13, right? Therefore, integral over C f dash z by f of z dz equals to minus 26 into pi. Okay, so without really finding what is f and what is f dash and taking its you know values and finding its real integration, we have applied argument principle to evaluate it. Okay, so let us see one more example, the final example. Example. Find the number of zeros of or P of z is nothing but z to the power of 10 minus 6 into z to the power of 9 minus 3z plus 1, okay, inside the unit circle mod z equals to 1. Okay, so what we are writing, or P of z I am writing as some f of z plus g of z. Okay, so my f of z is nothing but I am writing as minus 6 into z to the power of 9 plus 1 and g of z as z to the power of 10 minus 3z. Okay, so we have to see that mod g less than mod f or not. Okay, see, modulus of f of z is nothing but modulus of minus 6 into z to the power of 9 plus 1. Okay, so this can always be written as 6 into z to the power of 9, 6 into mod z to the power of 9 minus 1. So this is nothing but 6 minus 1 on mod z equals to 1. Okay, this is nothing but 5. So let us see what is our f of z, modulus of g of z. Modulus of g of z is nothing but mod z to the power of 10 minus 3z. So this is, if I use the triangle inequality, so this is mod z to the power of 10 plus 3 into mod z. So this is less than equals to 1 plus 3, this is equals to 4. Okay, therefore this 4 is less than or equals to 5, indeed strictly less than 5. So our 5 is nothing but, okay, 5 is less than or equals to modulus of f of z. Therefore modulus of g of z is strictly less than modulus of f of z on mod z equals to 1. Okay, now by Cauchy's theorem, f and f plus g have the same number of zeros. Theorem, f of z and f plus g of z have the same number of zeros. Okay, so now what, how many number of zeros are there for f? For f, how many number of zeros are there?
9, sir.
Okay, since f has 9 zeros inside mod z equals to 1, f of z plus g of z has 9 zeros inside mod z equals to 1. Okay, so one can use this Cauchy's theorem even to prove fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay, if you have a polynomial of degree n over C, it has n zeros. Okay, so one can use one can suitably write p of z properly. The here trick is how you are splitting the function into two parts. Okay, so here I'm stopping the lecture. Thank you.